Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could teach the gullible to never be so comfortable with knives they eat like comfort food? To disregard the bogus claims and pseudoscientific claims, can you imagine just how much indeed the world would change? No more political predators playing on the populace with ilkas and plots to shift and kill Metropolis. No more villains with the title in the Bible holding phony temper Bibles like the stuff they teach is vital. Imagine it was normal to have to prove a claim you made, and folks really feel ashamed expressing content that was fake. It's not to say we never make mistakes, it's just to say we go out of our way to show the evidence it takes.
Remain skeptical while you travel the world or even stay strapped with logic and facts.
That's what it is, yo.
Keep reality intact. Tell the truth, bro. Question every claim, especially the ones you believe in. Remain skeptical while you travel the world or reason.
This Sunday's edition of Road to Reason, A Skeptic's Guide to the 21st Century. I want to welcome you guys for being here watching the show. Today we have a very special guest. His name is Rob Boston, and he is the communications director for an organization called Americans United for the Separation of Church and State, which, as the name implies, they are an organization that tries to preserve the freedom of true freedom of religion for everybody in this country to worship or not worship however they please. So we'll be having an interesting conversation with Rob about the new administration, the new presidency, and how it'll affect church-state issues, and we'll begin into a lot of different issues about that. But before we get into that, I want to introduce my co-host here, Paul Sheehan, who also happens to be the creator and producer of Road to Reason.
I know nothing about that.
Nothing. So he's the one that wouldn't let me quit doing the show, you know, after right. I was, you know, but anywho, so let's also do some announcements, unless you got something quick to say.
Sure.
Go ahead. So
I wanted to talk about that if anybody's been watching the recent A&E show with Leah Remini on Scientology, one of the people she interviewed will be coming on, Aaron Smith 11. He has an interesting story to tell about how his family got into Scientology, and his twin brother wound up having to disconnect from him because he was declared a suppressive person.
Can you define what disconnect means?
Because it means they're not allowed to talk to your family members, or the church could go after you. Mm-hmm. And basically, his twin brother was forced to disconnect to stay in Scientology, and sadly, his brother committed suicide because he got depressed because Scientology was telling him he wasn't a good enough Scientologist. And he slipped into a depression and killed himself. And Aaron has a very interesting story to tell about how his mom was originally forced to disconnect from him, but then came around, and the struggles that family, which sadly is all too typical in Scientology, have gone through, and what they've lost and what they've survived. And he's going to be coming on. We don't have an exact date, but it'll be in the next month.
Okay, good.
He'll be coming on to talk about his trials and tribulations.
I can't wait for that show. You know, if you need a co-host for that, let me know. I might be able to jump on that.
Maybe.
Speaking of upcoming shows, I do want to mention that next week, the 29th, we will have David Tamayo will be back in the show. Or hosting the show, and he will be covering with exclusive coverage of the Women's March,
which I shot,
which Paul Sheehan shot, did all of the video work for that. So we'll do a special Road to Reason on that with exclusive coverage. Remember that, exclusive.
Yep, we got an interview with Dave Silverman, president of American Atheists.
Fantastic, among other people. I don't know.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a bunch of them.
Other people. So. Also in February, Rob Penzak and maybe me, but maybe another host, I'm not sure yet, but we'll be interviewing, this is on the 12th of February, August Brunsman, who is the executive director of the Secular Student Alliance. So that should be the Student Secular Alliance. That should be an interesting show. On January 8th, we had scheduled Roy Speckhart to be here in the studio. Unfortunately, we had to cancel that show because of the snowstorm we had. So we look for that, rescheduling of that interview, because that'll be an interesting talk with Roy Speckhart, who is the executive director for the American Humanist Association. And finally, for announcements, I want to mention that the Atheist Alliance of America, which is the organization that Rob Penzak, one of our producers here and hosts, has recently taken a position of executive director, is putting out a magazine in late July. It's called the Secular Nation magazine. And it will focus on an introduction to the new team. Atheist Alliance of America has gotten somewhat of a facelift, and there's some new members that will be running that organization. And also they'll have a focus in that in the Secular Nation magazine on this new recent election. So keep an eye out for that. All right, let's move forward to some news items real quick in about, you know, 3 minutes or so.
Crank them out, baby. We got to get to Rob Boston.
All right. So the first thing I want to talk about is, you know, there's been a lot of talk in this election about, who's qualified to be president, who isn't qualified to be president. You know, is it lawyers and people with advanced degrees, or is it businessmen or what? Well, there's another group that wants to throw their name in a hat of politics, and that's scientists. There's a group by the name of, it's an organization called STEM the Divide. STEM meaning the science, technology, engineering, and math acronym, that is trying to push scientists to run for public office or to become more politically involved. The reason being is because scientists by nature have a way to look at data and objectively try to assess results and or at least draw some conclusions from data in a way that's really not normally done in politics. This organization is started from a political action committee called 314 Action, and if any of you nerds are out there, 314 is the first three numbers of pi, the number pi. So anyways, look for that to be part of the fray in the political fray that, you know, seems to be changing here year by year, or election by election. All right, and then secondly, this next piece of news item will tie into our discussion with Rob Boston, and it has to do with the recent election, obviously, and most importantly, an article that came out from an organization by the name of the People for the American Way, who is very critical of one of Trump's nominees, the nominee for Secretary of Education, and her name is Betsy DeVos. I believe that's how you pronounce the name. And basically there's a lot of issues with this, obviously from a philosophical, but also from a conflict of interest issue, so they had to postpone her vote, a confirmation vote, till January 31st because of time for people to review these very complicated business ventures that not only DeVos, but many of Trump's, including Trump himself, nominees have ties to, the big business world. So I do want to mention one thing that Barry Lynn said real quick, and Barry Lynn is the executive director of Americans United for Separating Church and State, about DeVos, just to give you an idea of why they think it's a bad idea. The appointment of Betsy DeVos to oversee the U.S. Department of Education is an insult to public education. DeVos is a divisive figure who has spent much of her career working to privatize public education. She has fought to divert resources away from public schools into private, mostly religious institutions. She is the leader of the crusade to create school vouchers across the country. 90% of American children rely on public schools for an education. The country deserves an education secretary who will advocate for those children and their families and represent their interests. Instead, we have an ideologue who favors privatization of education. Private school vouchers violate the fundamental principle of religious freedom because they fund religious education with taxpayer dollars. And this is indeed a dark day for a public education in America, end quote. So it's going to be interesting to have this conversation with Rob Boston about DeVos and some other of Trump's nominees.
Yeah, I wanted to say, I think that one of the things we can talk to Rob about, and I think this for me is a newsworthy item because I think it's at the top of the heap when it comes to importance, which is the education of young people. It's that generation of future thinkers. And a lot of people make that mistake of thinking that, oh, this is just about free market. You know, the way they sell it is that Well, it's competition of good ideas. It's like if this school can teach kids better for cheaper, where's the harm? And what I think this really boils down to is getting public eyes off of the school so they can teach rhetoric that there's no accountability for, and start turning out kids that don't think or think that the way that they want to script them to think. And there's a huge, huge pitfall there for our country. And I am interested in what Rob's thoughts are on that.
Certainly there'll be plenty of opportunities for conversation on that topic, among others, because that's only one aspect of church-state separation issues that...
But I'd say it's probably one of the single most important ones.
I believe that as well. Education is the key to combating irrational ideologies, and that's clearly where we need to go. I also wanted to mention real quick that, as a humanist, as a moral and ethical person that I am, I have very long hair, and sometimes I go and get it cut, although not recently, and donate it to charities that donate it to, cancer patients, especially kids. They make, wigs out of them. It's the quickest and easiest and most painless thing anybody can do. If you can grow your hair out, cut it, and donate it. And it's just as simple as that. So I urge anybody with long hair to do that.
Well, yeah, the issue I have with that is that as far as it being quick and painless, they told me the same thing about my foreskin. And, I don't buy into that stuff anymore, man. People try to sell you that.
Yeah,
plus,
I don't think
I have the hair anymore.
Yeah, well, so. You've been... I guess that kind of ruined it for you, huh?
I've been lied to, man. I've been lied to.
All right, on that note, I think we are going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back with Rob Boston and to discuss church-state issues.
One of the goals of an atheist community is to provide support for those who find themselves without faith in light of mounting evidence against unfounded beliefs. Organizations with this goal range from skeptic groups to humanist service meetups to support groups for those who may have lost a community through their deconversion. In response to this, Recovering from Religion, an organization that seeks to support those who have left their faith, has recently launched the Hotline Project. This is not a deconversion hotline. The motive behind the project is to support a growing population of people who have left their faith and need to construct their identities around a new, beautiful reality. If you want more information, you can visit the Recovering from Religion website at recoveringfromreligion.org.
Good.
Homemade noodles. Oh. Marty, stop it. Oh my goodness, I'm so sorry. It reminds me, I've been thinking maybe we should try a new form of birth control. I heard about this one, it's called the IUD, intrauterine device. Or we could try the patch on your arm. Actually, I think that one goes on your butt.
Bedsider.org has birth control information and a lot more. And it's...
What do you think, though? Arm or the butt?
There's a lot of tree branches and dry brush over here. We should probably move the bonfire over there.
I'm guessing Smokey liked that idea.
This is Richard Dawkins. Doing commercials is unfamiliar territory for me, but I'm inviting you to watch Road to Reason, a skeptic's guide to the 21st century, on Fairfax Public Access every Sunday. Each week, the hosts tackle wishful thinking, religion, pseudoscience, and the harm they cause, with a combination of facts, humor, and community involvement. They challenge believers to defend their faith and give you, the skeptic, a voice. With live call-ins for viewers and streaming on the World Wide Web, there's never a dull moment. Don't wait. Look at them now on Facebook and YouTube, and remember to watch Road to Reason, a skeptic's guide to the 21st century. Or they'll be hell to pay.
All right,
We're
back. Welcome back. Joining us here, we have Rob Boston, and I want to do a quick introduction on who Rob Boston is. So he's the Director of Communications for Americans United for Separation of Church and State, which is an organization that is dedicated to preserving the constitutional principle of church-state separation as the only way to ensure true religious freedom for everyone, including the non-religious. He has worked at the AU for short since 1987.
87, yes.
Is that correct? And also you serve as the church and editor for Church and State magazine.
That's right.
Which is the editorial that Americans United puts out. In addition to that, Rob is also an author, and he's written 4 books. One of them, Close Encounters with the Religious Right, Journeys into the Twilight Zone of Religion and Politics, which is an interesting, it is a twilight zone. This was published by Prometheus Books in 2000. Also, he wrote The Most Dangerous Man in America, Pat Robertson and the Rise of the Christian Coalition, which was also published on Prometheus Books in 1996. Why the Religious Right is Wrong About Separation of Church and State, Prometheus Books in 1993, and then there was a second edition in 2003. And then the most recent book you wrote is called Taking Liberties, Why Religious Freedom Doesn't Give You the Right to Tell Other People What to Do, and that was published in 2014, correct?
Right.
All right. Well, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having
Again,
me.
Again, you've been on our show, I think,
a couple times before. Yes, glad to be back.
Awesome. So,
you're always welcome.
Yeah,
thanks.
And we always love to have you. So, the big thing that I want to touch on today is obviously implications of church-state separation in regards to the new administration that just got sworn in this last Friday. Primarily, I'm seeing a lot of issues with some of his appointments, and I want to start out, as we were discussing before the break, to talk about Betsy DeVos, I think is her name.
DeVos.
I thought I had it right, and then I got it wrong again. So she's a champion of privatizing the school system. Why is that wrong?
Well, I think one of the things we have to remember about Betsy DeVos is this is somebody who has virtually no experience with public education in any facet. Her children didn't go to public schools. She's never been inside of a public school classroom, as far as we know. In fact, seems hostile to the whole concept. I mean, traditionally, in the past, the Secretary of Education has been a man or a woman who actually supports public education, mm-hmm. because 90% of American children are attending public schools, mm-hmm. so it's important to have somebody who's going to be an advocate for that system. And Betsy DeVos is not. She has spent her life working on privatization schemes. Now, when you look at the whole idea of privatization at the secondary level, most people will talk about a voucher plan.
Mm-hmm.
You get some competition into the system, and this is what we're told. But what they don't tell you is that this has actually been tried in a number of states. There are voucher plans in Ohio, Indiana,
Michigan.
I mean, there's a number of them out there.
Right.
And they vary in scope and size, but they have not really delivered.
Mm-hmm.
And what usually happens is they tend to be a bailout for religious school systems.
Mm-hmm.
The vast majority of private schools in this country are religious in nature.
Right.
A lot of them are Roman Catholic, others fundamentalist Protestant, small number of mainline Protestant and some Jewish academies and mm-hmm. some Muslim academies as well. But really, you're talking about religious school systems. And I don't for a minute dispute their right to exist and
sure.
with their own money, that's fine. But now they are increasingly demanding taxpayer support,
right.
and that, of course, leads to a person being compelled to pay taxes to support a religious school system. And I think that's just a modern-day version of the old church taxes mm-hmm. from the colonial period.
Is there a possibility that in that type of a situation, they say that you're Muslim, and the school district largely just becomes private Catholic schools, and they're you're a super minority in that community. Are you going to be forced then to go to a Catholic school to get an education at that point because there's no alternative?
Well, under an entirely privatized system, mm-hmm. obviously we could see some parts of the country, maybe smaller towns or rural areas, where there wouldn't be a lot of choice. There wouldn't be a wide array of schools to choose from. I mean, one of the things the free market folks are always telling us is that the free market will provide this great variety of things. And the free market certainly does provide a great variety of some things, breakfast cereal is an example, and there are hotel chains and whatever. But when you bring those forces to play in public education at the secondary level, you're really talking about an untested
sure.
type of a thing. That would be a really radical departure from what we have done in this country. I mean, the public school system And I concede that in some parts of the country there are problems with it. My answer to that would be to fix it, not abandon it. But right. The idea of the public school system, when it was sort of conceived and got in place roughly after the period of the Civil War is when it really began to take off, to bring everybody together, that you would educate various religious groups alongside one another, and maybe get over some of these sectarian divisions that had been a problem. To go back to a system where you're kind of balkanizing along religious lines, I think is going to be a real problem. And from the perspective of I know a lot of folks watching the show obviously are skeptical of organized religion. They're atheists, agnostics, humanists, freethinkers, what have you. There probably aren't going to be a lot of choices for those folks.
Right. And you know, the idea behind, you know, a public education system that's based off secular ideas is that it kind of puts everybody on an equal playing field.
Right.
And it doesn't, you don't have as much, you know, indoctrination towards one religion over another, which essentially is very important if you're trying to maintain religious
and
liberty.
Another thing to consider is, you know, you have to remember what a lot of these schools are teaching. It can be very controversial or exclusive towards certain members of our society. For example, the fundamentalist Christian academies, they don't teach mainstream science.
Right.
They teach creationism instead. Now again, with their own money, although I think that is a huge mistake to ever do that to a child, because it limits their options. You know, if they don't get the proper education somewhere down the line, they're probably not going to end up being a paleontologist or an archaeologist or, you know, some other scientific field if they've been brought up in creationism. But those schools have the right to do it with their own money. When you bring the taxpayer dollars into that, that's you and me subsidizing, you know, Ken Ham's fundamentalist Christian academy, where he's teaching them that Noah's Ark is a factual thing and that there were baby dinosaurs on the Ark, or, you know, whatever nonsense he believes that is disputed by and debunked by mainstream science. That's one thing. Another thing to consider is how many of these religious schools are teaching members are treating members of the LGBTQ community. They will fire a teacher if they find out that they're involved in a same-sex relationship. They will fire a woman if she gets pregnant outside of wedlock. They will fire you for if they find out you don't believe in all of their doctrines. The non-belief community has especially to be concerned about that, because although it isn't as much talked about, members of that community are also discriminated against by these religious schools.
Oh, absolutely.
And they don't, you know, they don't want them. They don't want the students from that community in the schools. So, you know, again, the bottom line is you're talking here about people being taxed to support a system that is hostile to them, that's teaching bad science, that's elevating dogma over education in most instances.
And in a privatized system, they can hide behind First Amendment rights.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, that's what's so frustrating about this. We've had this voucher plan operating in a number of states for years now. There's even a federal program in Washington, D.C. And there is precious little accountability. I mean, a lot of us were naive, maybe, in thinking that when these plans got instituted, there would at least be some kind of a law that would make sure the kids were learning.
Some kind of standards that are applied to all of the private schools.
You know, it's interesting to bring that up. There are states where they started out with those kind of testing standards. But when the students failed to perform well, they did away with the testing for the private schools. So clearly, once these systems get established, there's really no shutting them down, no matter how poorly they may be performing. And in most states, it has been a disaster. There are schools participating in a Washington, D.C. Voucher program that really are just storefront academies. And some of them are religious in nature and are teaching very controversial things. So, you know, again, we just need to remember that the tax dollars need to fund a system that's open to everybody and that is not sectarian, but is secular instead.
How do you think the people who are pushing this agenda are handling it from an honesty standpoint? Do you think they're being transparent with what their real objectives are, or do you think that they're selling this as purely free market? I guess take it to another level is, what example specifically have you seen that is detrimental to the development of young people take place that are not being disclosed by these people?
I think, Paul, there are really three strands of thought that come into play here when you're talking about this privatization plan. One would be the Catholic education system. Now, I should point out that personally, when I was raised in Western Pennsylvania in an Irish Catholic family, I attended a Catholic school for 8 years, and in my town, which was about 65,000 people at that time, there were, you know, five or six Catholic schools. Well, there's one left now. And that scenario has been played out all over the country. the shrinking of the parochial school system. Now, that's happened for a number of different reasons. And I won't get into all those, but the point is that the system is shrinking. And the Catholic Church, leadership of the Catholic Church, looks at that and they're alarmed. And
they're alarmed, right?
You know, they want us to prop up that system. Instead of just sort of accepting that this is just a thing that happens sometimes for various reasons, people shift over to public systems, they want that bailout from the taxpayer. Right. So that's the first strand, hierarchy of the Catholic Church seeking a bailout for a school system that, quite frankly, is troubled. Second strand would be the fundamentalist Protestants who hate public education because mm-hmm. it's godless. You know, they're always saying that. It teaches secular humanism. I mean, we've been hearing this stuff for years. So they want vouchers and they want tax support so they can get out of the public school system and they can teach things like creationism that they can't legally teach in the public school system. They can teach their fake view of the Christian nation of history view yep. of American history. They want to teach that. The extreme anti-LGBTQ views that you would yep. not find in a public school, they want to teach that. So that's the second strain. Third strain are the free marketeers. And the free marketeers are people who just on ideological grounds hate anything the government does, right. whether it's effective or not.
Whether it's effective or not.
It's ideology. It's completely ideologically driven. So the public school system, which in many parts of the country works quite well for people, they don't care about that. They want to get rid of it because it's run by the government and they hate anything the government does.
Well, let me add one more strain to that, corporatism. There are people out there that want to make money off of education.
Yes, that's a good point. I mean, think about the billions of dollars that are spent yeah. on public education every year. That is a huge amount of money and they'd like to get some of that. You're absolutely
like
right.
So I guess more back to finishing up the thought on that is, do you think people like, was it Mary DeVos? Do you think she's being honest with where she's coming from, or do you think the American people could be enlightened by an agenda that maybe she has that she's not being open about?
Well, you know, I mean, all of her career, she's been pretty clear that she would like to see resources shifted from the public sector to the private sector. Mm-hmm. I don't think she's really tried to hide that. Right. She's funded organizations and created organizations that work toward that. She's poured a lot of money into the campaigns of candidates who support that view. What's mm-hmm. so shocking to me is that someone like that, with no track record of support for public education, has been nominated to be the Secretary of the Education Department in the right. United States. I mean, that is stunning, but it's par for the course for this administration. It's a new administration, but we're already seeing that one of its sort of plans is to bring people into these departments who don't actually support the core mission of the department. And it's destructive.
It's almost as if this administration is trying to purposely derail these departments by putting people who are, you know, essentially against the idea of
yeah.
these departments.
Yeah, they don't agree with what they do.
One of the things that, one of the analogies I've been using about, is we are in a, almost an antithesis of the Sputnik moment. Back in the 50s when Russia was beating us to space. So the government decided to, we need to educate our youth to right. with science and math. And so they developed science standards, which included things like evolutionary theory, what I am seeing now is sort of a backtracking of that, with people like Betsy DeVos, who don't really care whether children learn proper
It's discouraging. And what's so discouraging about it is that I think most of us would agree that if you look at the future, the years ahead, mm-hmm. those types of jobs, the STEM jobs, science, right. technology, engineering, mathematics, that's growth.
Right.
People aren't going to be working, and they're already not working in factories in this country right. anymore. And there are only so many service economy jobs. Yeah. But there's growth, and there are good jobs in
sure.
STEM. And to kind of shut that off for a generation of young people by teaching them this junk science, really, right. I think it's a dereliction of duty. It is.
Well, when you talk about service industry, it's interesting to look at how that's disappearing. America right now is still largely a service industry, service-based industry, a nation, and we have Google cars, Uber is already trying to replace drivers in San Francisco. We have companies like CVS eliminating cashiers. We have companies like Amazon that want to do deliveries by drone. We're eliminating people right and left from service industry positions. And it looks like the technology is going to continue to make that more likely, and that's going to continue to be an erosion of labor in this country for those types of jobs. So where else do you turn except to the STEM STEM fields.
Well, for those jobs that are being replaced by technology, you need people to design the technology.
Right.
And I'm not saying that everyone is capable of, successfully completing a STEM education. I mean, it's not for everybody, and we still need other jobs. We need people that can fix cars. We need people that can, pick up trash. And all these jobs are needed. Plumbers, electricians, trade jobs especially, we need a balance of
right.
that, I think, in a public school system. What we don't need, however, is false dogma or dogmatic beliefs being taught as objective truths.
And this is that's a good point. And there's another factor of that to consider that, I'm old-fashioned enough to believe that education sometimes is just for its own sake.
Mm-hmm.
It isn't just so you'll take your slot in a corporation somewhere. Yeah, you do want to study and have a plan and think about what you're going to do for a living. That's fine.
Right.
But I also think that a well-educated, well-rounded individual drinks deeply from the well of the humanities and dabbles in science if that's not their main field but wants to get a little bit involved in that, studies foreign languages, experiences other cultures. There's so many other things you can do. And I sometimes get the impression someone who's traveled in the world of the religious right, has been to their meetings and looks at their books and their websites and their magazines, that they don't actually think any of that's a good idea.
No.
That exposure to the larger world, that idea of challenging yourself, exposing yourself to new ideas through literature, art, and philosophy is actually dangerous because it might lead you to question some of the assumptions that they would like everybody to just accept uncritically.
Right.
And it pains me to believe that about people, but I've encountered the view enough to know that it's out there.
Oh, no, I would totally agree with you, and that's the reason why the Christian right wants to do away with secular public education. They are afraid because they're seeing the numbers. There was a Christian apologist who actually debated Christopher Hitchens at VCU here in Richmond. I was part of organizing that. I'm drawing a blank on his name now, but he in his ministry and on his website, that's one of the things that he always stresses. We are losing our youth to education, to public colleges. He says the number one reason why the youth leaves college or leaves the faith is when they get into college and they get exposed to
A
wide variety of ideas.
They're also very threatened by the internet. I've had discussions with them, and they believe that, and I've said, I think the reason why you, the religious right, are losing people is because people are able to communicate that they're not the monsters that you claim that they are, that they're able to put a human face on themselves, and that people are able to question their own beliefs in a place that's safe, where they're not afraid of peer pressure. They're able to go into community. So the internet is certainly a threat to them. But I'm really interested in, Rob, what you and Americans United see as real threats from this administration versus perceived ones. Are we at a point yet where we can really start to define what those threats might be as far as separation of church and state, or do we need a little more time?
Well, I think there are a couple things we need to be looking at. During the campaign, Trump talked about a nationwide voucher plan with a price tag of $20 billion. Now, that's a billion with a B.
Wow.
Now, that's huge. That's enormous. That's a gigantic program. Are they going to do something like that? Are they going to create a program that large? Well, probably not, because Trump's style is to throw something out that's just, completely ridiculous, way right. ambitious, and then negotiate back from that point. So maybe they'll have a smaller plan instead that they'll try to push through. And with the Republicans in control of the House and the Senate, that's a real threat. So we need to be looking at that. Another area where he talked about during the campaign was doing away with the federal law that bars nonprofits, including houses of worship, from getting involved in partisan elections by endorsing or opposing candidates. Now, if they did that, all these houses of worship, all these TV ministries, all these other types of groups that are religious in nature, and secular nonprofits could jump right into partisan politics and start operating like little political action committees. That's a federal law. That's not something that's in the Constitution. So they can remove that by changing the tax code. Is Trump really going to push that? Well, we talked a lot about it during the campaign. I think the idea was put into his head by Jerry Falwell Jr. I don't think Trump knew a thing about that law until Jerry Falwell started talking about it.
And Pence.
There's a couple of jokes there to be made about Trump not knowing a lot of things, but that's all right.
but that's second. Third area I would say that we need to really be looking at is, and this is the one I see as the most threatening, is the composition of the courts.
Right.
We have an open Supreme Court seat right now. Trump's saying he's going to fill it with somebody like Antonin Scalia, who held the seat prior to his death. And then there's 100 open seats in the lower federal courts.
Yes. Is it 100? I heard it was more than that.
Maybe. Yeah. I heard 100, but could be more. But it's a lot of seats. The issue of separation of church and state and First Amendment rights and a lot of other rights are usually ultimately decided by a panel of judges somewhere, whether it's the Supreme Court or a lower panel or whatever. So those judges are very important.
Yeah, the federal courts are extremely important.
Yeah, the opinions that they write, you know, as they move up the chain in the courts, either hold water or they don't. So, you know, how well-rounded a judge writes a decision is going to have a lot of impact as to whether circuit courts or Supreme Courts will uphold it or overrule it. And I guess this is one of the areas that I'd like to talk about, which is, when it comes to the laws of this land and separation of church and state, the organizations like Americans United, American Atheists, Secular Coalition, Freedom from Religion, in my opinion, and I may be wrong in this, have seemed largely to have fought defensive battles. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, is this maybe the time where we need to start looking at going on the offensive, start looking at some of the worst abuses that religions are engaged in with separation of church and state, maybe looking at just certain churches that abuse their tax-exempt status to a point that I think the average person would have a problem with it, and start maybe demanding in our courts and through our legislators some change?
Well, there may be an opening for that. And I think the way to look at that is, look at how the policies of some religious organizations and laws that protect them are affecting vulnerable populations. Let me give you an example. In a number of states, I don't know the number, but there are laws that protect people who engage in faith healing to the extent that they won't take their children to see doctors even when they've got really serious illnesses. Well, you could look at closing those loopholes. Even a conservative Congress or a conservative state legislature, one would think would be open to a discussion like that, because you're talking about a very vulnerable population, children. Mm-hmm. You know, adults have the right to refuse medical treatment if they want, for whatever reason, but these are children, and someone is making the decision for them, and it's not a decision that is in their best interest sometimes. That's one area to look at. There are some other areas that some groups have been sort of getting a little traction with. Recently, for example, right, one of his last actions before leaving office, President Obama signed a new international religious freedom law that extended the protections to non-believers for the first time. Okay. That was something that the American Humanist Association and a couple other non-theistic groups actually partnered with some of the more conservative organizations and brought that around. So that was an example of kind of proactive kind of activity that we can see. Another area where I've seen some movement is you know, often as we have these sort of, you know, there'll be International Year of the Bible or some resolution will get passed and it's Bible Week or what have you. Mm-hmm. Well, I don't much like those, and they're hard to fight in court, but some groups have been pushing for that, for like Darwin Day and getting that introduced. Now, it's not been passed yet at the federal level, but some local jurisdictions have passed it, and I think some state governors have signed those proclamations. Right. Now, you know, one could look at that and say, oh, you know, it's just a resolution. Yeah, it's a baby step. But it's an important one because it gets the organization into the game, gets them in there into lobbying, shows them how to, you know, get things done. And maybe that could then, the lessons they learn there can be applied toward actual laws down the line. Mm-hmm. This is going to be difficult. I mean, make no mistake, especially in the U.S. Congress, very conservative. We know we're going to have a difficult time in the years to come. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we're going to keep at it.
I guess, like, where, you know, England has this thing, it's called a public benefits test. In order for a church, say, to have tax exemption, it has to prove that it does some value, some good for the community. And, you know, we talked prior to coming on today, I talked about some of the abuses of Scientology. You know, it's a particularly notorious sect out there. And I don't know that we could get a religious benefits test because of the separate, you know, there's no religious test per se. Yes. But I think that when organizations are engaged in criminal behavior, behavior that is blatantly abusive, perhaps, you know, we're talking about with the faith healing that you were mentioning, that maybe the American public would support some type of reforms that could keep some of the more out of line religions in check, and also serve notice to the other religions that, you know, the public does have a means of pushing.
Right. Well, there is some precedent for that. I mean, generally speaking, religious freedom has been interpreted very broadly in this country, so that there's a great reluctance for anybody, you know, for the government to come in and try to tell people can't do certain things. But clearly dangerous practices. Mm-hmm. Snake handling, for example. Snake handling is illegal in most states, and there mm-hmm. are occasional prosecutions for that, and people recognize that's just a dangerous practice, and even though the people who engage in it say, well, you know, it's in the Bible, we get to do it, state has said, no, that's too dangerous, and we can mm-hmm. stop that. In the case of groups that are engaging in, you know, outright lawbreaking, I think there should be a little more of an aggressive stance. Unfortunately, what we're seeing now is there's this cult of victimization among religious groups in this country. They're constantly claiming they're being persecuted. Rights are being violated. As a matter of fact, and I document some of this in my 2014 book, Taking Liberties, I have a list of all the benefits and privileges religious groups get in this country, mm-hmm. and it's considerable. And it's not even the full list.
And these are also privileges that, by the way, are specific
to religion in many cases.
You know, even if they are 501c3s, some 501c3s, like secular organizations, don't get the same privileges that some of these religious 501c3s.
Well, let me just—I don't want to derail us too much, but okay, I want to give you an interesting example of that recently, because this is something that applies to religious organizations. You know, some people—there aren't many of them around—but there are still some people who get pensions, mm-hmm. divine benefit pensions. Well, religious organizations have been exempt from the law that there are laws that try to keep people from looting. You know, a company from looting employee pensions. You know, there's at least something out there that does that. It's a little bit of control and oversight. Well, religious groups are exempt from that, and that was meant so that, you know, if you work for the United Church or something, mm-hmm. or you work for the Baptist, the government won't be coming in looking at that. But now religious hospitals are claiming that benefit, and they're mm-hmm. looting employees' pensions. And think about religious hospitals. Most of the people who work there aren't members of the religion that sponsors the hospital,
right.
in most cases.
Exactly.
And yet they're finding that they're getting ready to retire, suddenly there's no pension because this religious group claimed this exemption that does exist in the law for religious organizations not meant to be applied to hospitals. The Supreme Court's going to look at that issue mm-hmm. during this term.
Yeah.
Very important case. People need to understand there is a bunch of laws out there like that give exemptions to religious organizations in ways that people aren't even thinking about.
Right.
I mean, some of the people in this hospital case, they had no idea their pensions were at risk because they didn't know that the hospitals had claimed this exemption. So people need to be aware of that. Far from being, you know, pressed down upon or having their rights taken away, religious groups have great latitude. And it has, I think, led the government to take a position of not wanting to intervene, even in cases where there is blatant lawbreaking, harassment, attacking of people, as some of these groups have done. So there could be a little more aggression out there. Now, in the case of Scientology, I think the government is especially skittish because, as you might remember, there was a huge fight over that church's tax exemption, which the government and the IRS for many years did try to deny and eventually gave up and allowed the church to have it. So they, I think, have been a little bit wary since then, having lost that battle.
It also seems, too, like that the government and our courts seem to almost kind of err always on the side of religion and for instance, you know, we talk about the separation of church and state, as in religions can pretty much do what they want and the state can't really intervene, yet they benefit from the state. Like, you know, there'll be a baker who won't want to bake a cake,
right.
yet that business uses our fire departments, they use our police departments, they use our roadways, they use our public works, our sanitation. So they're tied in to us in a broader sense of they're not really completely isolated, but the person's religious beliefs somehow allow them to discriminate. And it just seems to me, it's like, you know, our law says there's separation of church and state. And I've heard religious people say, well, there really isn't anything that says separation of church and state. And they are correct, but that's the point. There's also, you can turn that on its head. There's nothing that says that you aren't covered by not having to pay your taxes. Mm-hmm. If you want to just go to the pure letter of what it says, all these exemptions you're getting aren't really there either.
The Constitution doesn't even, there's no mention of capitalism. There's no mention of, you know, how, you know, so you know, when you play these games, these...
These word games. It's tiresome.
Is this a sentiment thing? Is this just like politicians being afraid of taking a stance because they think that the churches can work up the voting base?
Well, that's part of it. I mean, part of it is just the natural deference to religion in this society, which is just shot through the whole society, and it's been around for a long time. What we're seeing right now is exemptions that were intended for religious organizations are being claimed by religious individuals. Let me give you an example of that. A church doesn't have to allow you to be a member. It can deny you service. You know, if you walk into the Mormon church and you're not a Mormon and you start demanding that you want to go to the services and get married, they're going to tell you to hit the bricks until you become a Mormon. And that's as it should be.
Right.
But it does not follow from that that you can walk into a bakery and say, I want you to make a cake for me and my same-sex partner, and have the baker say, oh, you know, I'm completely against those relationships, even though the Supreme Court has said that's permissible, and I'm not going to do it as an individual. Right. That is an individual attempting to claim, I think, a right that was really intended for religious organizations.
Constitution's now, not.
Right. It's been complicated because there's a federal law that was passed in the early 90s called the Religious Freedom Restoration Act that was intended to provide protect minority religious expression. It's been misinterpreted. The court has applied it in ways it was never intended, I think. And it's complex.
Yeah.
But this is what we're seeing now. People making this claim that's basically like to the point where you get a Kim Davis, a government employee in Kentucky, who says, I'm not going to do my job. Mm-hmm. Furthermore, I'm not going to allow my employees to do the job either because it offends my religion. And this was actually taken seriously. Now, she didn't do very well in court, but a Republican governor came into Kentucky and changed the law basically to make it so that her name doesn't have to appear on the wedding licenses anymore. But in the interim, you know, a certain number of people were trying to get wedding licenses in that county, and they were same-sex, and they couldn't do it.
They got denied. Okay.
Their rights were somehow less important than the rights of Kim Davis when there was another person in that office who would have been happy to give them that license.
And keeping in mind that this all happened after a Supreme Court decision. Mm-hmm.
And Kim Davis and that office were not a church, so how could they?
Exactly.
In
fact, they were government employees. I mean, to me, the people who are at least able to claim that type of protection are government employees.
Right.
I mean, the first duty of the government is, you got to serve everybody.
Right.
You treat them all equally. That's the first command to the state. If you're not willing to do that, then quit.
And that's the But that's the how. You know, religious freedom is, you know, they're trying to twist and reinterpret what that really means, and it's they're trying to use it as an excuse to be able to, be bigots against whoever they want if they believe that it's, you know.
Yeah, they want to turn it. It's sad because religious freedom, and when I say religious freedom, I mean the right to not believe too.
Sure.
Religious freedom is a very noble concept. Mm-hmm. One of the things that our country pioneered, we should be proud of it. That separation, that division protects religious freedom, and they're turning it into something really ugly and nasty and
petty.
Well,
they're turning it into something that religious freedom in this country and the freedom and a separation of church and state was designed to do, or not designed to do in the first place. For you know, what I mean is, you know, establishing any religion, essentially theocracy or Christian nationalism, is exactly why the founders, enshrined that in the First Amendment is to stop any single one religion from taking over a government because they actually cherished the freedom that their predecessors were escaping from Europe. The Protestants who were escaping,
The court used to be very clear on that, Supreme Court. I mean, if you go back and look at the old Mormon polygamy case from the 19th century, the court in that case says basically, look, you have the right to believe whatever you want.
Sure.
But just by necessity, the state has the power to curtail some actions if they are seen as damaging or injurious to the larger society, in which case they'd said plural marriage was. So you had that standard for a long time, and then it just somehow got just turned into this thing where suddenly religious freedom gives you the right to discriminate, to take away other people's rights, to deny them services that should be available to everyone. And that's not what it was intended
for. I just find it amazing that they want to claim separation of church and state, but they want to use our state courts in order to make that argument. It's like at every turn they use the state to exempt themselves from church and state. The mechanism to me is almost ludicrous.
Well, they favor a doctrine of separation of church and state where the freedom of religion aspect of that is just blown
it's
up
dominant.
To enormous proportions.
Right.
And the establishment proportion is a little tiny thing that they will only invoke when they want to stop, like, the Muslims from doing something.
Bingo.
You know? Or Hindus or some other religion
or
they
atheists.
Decide they don't like.
Or
atheists. You know, at that point, they'll come in and they'll say, oh, you know, we can't have this book read in school because it teaches, you know, something about Islam we don't like. Then they try to invoke that. But that obviously that's not the way it was intended to be. The two ideas need to be in balance.
The prime example for that was, and you know, it's the irony is just so sweet here with the Satanists, and you know, you have the Satanists have been really throwing a wrench into the Christian, right? Because you know, they wanted to have after school clubs that are Christian based. Well, Satanists said, okay, if you're going to allow it, then open up the floodgates, and here come the Satanists, and that scared everybody into actually stopping that program. Right. Very effective method, by the way, to...
We had a similar case like that in Florida where they had these different religious displays in the Capitol building, in the rotunda.
Oh, yeah.
And they had a nativity scene there and a menorah. And they actually had a flying spaghetti monster.
Yep.
So they had some kind of offbeat things. But when the Satanists came in and wanted to put up their display, which was an angel falling into a pit of flames, they were like, no, we're not going to do this. Now, we had to threaten to sue them, and they put it up for a year. But then the year after that, they just shut down the whole forum.
So that's what kind of happened also in Loudoun County, where I used to live. Same kind of issue up there. But
we have some challenges that are coming our way for people who care about the separation of church and state and secularism. What do you see as something that people need to do to start mobilizing that's going to be effective to meet these challenges?
Well, it's not going to be easy because we're outnumbered, we're outgunned, but we just need to start getting a little more active on all the different levels. Paying attention to what's being promoted in Congress and in your state legislature. Interacting with your lawmakers. Speaking out. You know, the old sort of stuff that we've been doing for years. But, and this is, I think, you know, most important, through the proper channels, you got to get involved in the political system. Now, I say through the proper channels because organizations like my own, which are tax exempt, and other types of groups, a lot of the humanist free thought groups, same thing, tax exempt, those aren't really places for political activity. But there are plenty of places that are appropriate for that, that have the right tax status. Get people registered to vote, get them turned out. I used to, I still do, you know, would go to these religious right meetings, and that was their strategy. I mean, it wasn't anything terribly underhanded in most cases. Some of the stuff they do, trying to get churches to endorse candidates, that's illegal.
Right.
But a lot of it is just good old-fashioned political organizing. Identifying your target audience, getting them registered, physically transporting them to the polls on election day if you have to. I mean, we're very divided right now in this country, but it's a close divide. And if people are involved and they're active, you know, that will help. One of the messages I took from the Women's March, which I did attend, was that there's a lot of energy and activism on our side, right? That's great. But it won't translate into victory if we don't continue to press it forward into the political arena.
And that's
the next step.
One of the biggest points that I've been trying to make for a long time now on various media, whether it's on a show or on Facebook or whatever, is that, there's a lot of angry people out there. Protesters, people that are angry. Turn that energy.
Yes, use it.
Into, actual, substance. And I always tell people to get involved in local politics, especially because that's where a lot of even these politicians that make it all the way up to the national politics, that's where they start. School boards, which is a very important place to be involved. Even if you don't have kids in the district, go to the school board meetings. Voice your opinion. Board of Supervisors, counties and cities and city councils and things like that. All very important. Go to the subcommittees because a lot of times people don't know that these subcommittees are open to the public, but no one ever shows up. So what happens is, they get together and they do what they want without any public oversight.
Right.
These people are supposed to be representatives. They're supposed to be representative politics as well. And if the vast majority of the people that are showing up to these meetings are voicing an opinion, if the vast majority of the phone calls they're getting, emails and letters are stating they are supposed to, whether they do or not, they're supposed to reflect the majority opinion of what's coming their way.
And I will tell you, numbers matter. Voters in a jurisdiction matter. The higher the number, the better. Prime example is the ethics board that the Republicans were trying to gut.
Right, exactly.
As the first act of Congress. Well, guess what happened? There was a huge backlash.
Yeah.
I was hearing accounts where senators and congressmen were getting so many phone calls a day and letters and things about, what are you doing? They backtracked.
Yeah.
So it does.
Yeah, there are certainly issues where you create so much noise, they can't ignore it.
Right.
And we're probably going to be doing a lot of that over the next few years, but it works.
We've got a few minutes left, and I just wanted to talk real quick about, you talked about, you went to this protest, you talked about a divide. I'd like to talk a little bit, and I only got a few minutes, about the divide in the atheist and secular community over some of the issues that we see, some of the infighting that goes on over things like feminism, Black Lives Matter. And I want to talk about the importance of solidarity, about working with people where you can find common ground.
Right.
And, I just got a feeling dark days are coming. And I think we're going to have to really start looking at our first world problems a little differently, and we'll want to know what your thoughts are on that.
Well, that's very important. I understand there's robust discussion, there's very passionate debate over some of these issues. Let that continue. But let's keep working together. And also, let's not forget that we have a lot of allies in the religious community.
Yes, there is.
Liberal and moderate folks and others are very much on our side, and I really want us to work with them. At Americans United, we're a coalition, and we include liberal believers and moderates and probably even some conservative religious people, and then non-believers as well. And we're reaching out to a lot of other religious communities that are feeling threat right now. The idea is you just build this big wide coalition as much as possible, get as many voices into this thing as possible.
Yeah, and that's a key thing that you mentioned is now is the time to put differences aside and really start to look at who can help.
Right.
If we all share the same end goal, which is ultimately upholding the separation of church and state, it's beneficial to religious people.
Yeah, and there are sometimes, there are some issues where maybe you can't work together. That's fine.
Then
go work on an issue where you can work together.
Exactly.
And have some effect there.
And I think it's just very important, too, to identify what the real threats are, because there's a lot of rhetoric going around right now. Unfortunately, some guy made the decision the other day to light himself on fire in D.C. over Trump's election. People seem to be reacting in ways that are not helpful on issues that, and I think we're just in the early stages of just figuring out. I mean, the people he's appointing are bad.
Well, there's a lot of emotion,
but
things going on right now, too.
So, exactly what it means is something we're going to have to continue examining. And so I'd like to make sure that you have an invitation to come back as the election has now passed and we're starting to go into
also,
4 years of this.
Yeah, and also to discuss, we didn't get a chance to go over today, but some of his other nominees, and we'll see who ends up actually getting confirmed or not. But as time goes by, we definitely would like to have you back,
absolutely.
Kind of on a semi-regular basis to discuss what's going on, because you obviously have your pulse on this, and to shed some light on some of these issues that go oftentimes sort of buried. Right.
We will have no shortage of things to discuss. I'm confident of that.
Yeah.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, Americans United, Rob Boston. If you're interested in making a difference, this is an organization that has a track record of doing that when it comes to issues of separation of church and state.
www.au.org.
That's right.
Check them out and let us know what you think. Thank you.
Thank you, Mitch.
And. Go.